podcast.
Bye.
Bye. You're the king of these people. You're the lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope for the hopeless. You're the peace for the restless.
Good morning.
Welcome to Barclay Viewforth Church.
Good morning, dear Barclay Viewforth Church. Welcome to this Sunday morning service. It is good to come together, to gather, although being scattered across Edinburgh. And so let us come together, united in prayer, united in praising God. And we do this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I would just like to remind you of two more events or appointments we have planned today. At 3 p.m. we have our reflective service in the afternoon in the sanctuary in the Barclay Viewforth Church. If you would like to join, please do sign up beforehand. So if you hear about this today the first time, please sign up for next week so you can join us then. Also, I would like to tell you about our prayer meeting, which will be held online on Zoom at 6:45. Please do join us for this, and you will see the invitation in the chat to my left-hand side. My next point and last point is I would like to invite all of you Kingdom Kids to our Kingdom Kids service online edition again here on Church Online at 11 a.m. I'm looking forward to spending time together. This will be in 2 weeks, that is the 18th of October. Now let's direct our attention towards God, the reason why we breathe, the reason why we are here together. And let's sing, praise Him, praise Him. The chorus calls out to us.
Thank you.
Hi kids, it's good to see you. I hope you're having a good Sunday morning. Well, I brought something with me. It is a shirt. So you can see it in full. Well, I got this shirt about 2 years ago from Women of the Karen people. I visited them in a little village. And after my 10-day visit, they gave me this shirt, this traditional shirt, out of their kindness, out of their gratitude and love. And it really moved me. And this shirt, to be honest, might be the most valuable piece of clothing I own because of the love they gave this to me. And because of the littleness they had materially, they didn't care how little or how much they had. And yet, out of their generosity, they decided to give this up and to share this with me. Now, today's story is also about giving something up. God had a really big thing to ask of Abraham. He asked Abraham to give up his son. And if you click on this link, that will lead you right to our webpage where you find the videos telling the story and to some crafts idea. But for now, I would just like to encourage you and to talk with your mom and dad and think about, when was the last time someone gave something up for you? Or where could you give something up for someone else out of your generosity? Because to be honest, that reminded me, this shirt reminds me not only how these lovely women gave something up for me and gave me a present, but how Jesus does that on a daily basis. Jesus spares his time. Jesus shares his time and his love with me every day. So, chat with your mom and dad. Where did you give something up, or where did someone else give something up for you? Let's pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day your daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amazing, I am a friend of God. of glory, you have called me friend. God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have called me friend. God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have called me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
We're walking through the book of Genesis, which is made up of these two main parts.
And the first part begins in the garden, where we watch humanity spiral downward in self-destruction, and it ends in the Tower of Babel, where a rebellious humanity is scattered by God.
Then the second part of Genesis zooms in and focuses on just one family.
And right in the middle is this story that links the two parts of Genesis together and helps us understand what the whole book is all about.
So how do we get from the Tower of Babel to the story here in the middle?
Well, after the scattering at Babel, there's this genealogy, and it follows one of the tribes all the way down to this one guy named Abram.
You probably know him as Abraham.
And God starts making all these promises to Abraham, like he's going to bless him and give him a ton of kids. And he says that through him and his family, all the nations of the earth are now going to find God's blessing. So basically, God is trying to restore humanity back to the goodness of the garden and to his original intentions for the world. So it's like his rescue plan for humanity. And that's why the whole second half of Genesis is about this one family. And so you have.
Sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham." "Here I am," he replied. Then God said, "Take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain I will show you." Early the next morning, Abraham got up and loaded his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. He said to his servants, "Stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. We will worship and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father Abraham, "Father?" "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "The fire and the wood are here," Isaac said, "but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Amen.
Thank you, Ed, for the reading of today's passage. And the reading ended with a question. Isaac's question to his father. Well, where is that present? Where is the sacrifice? Where is the lamb we are going to present to God? Now, this story we just heard makes us rather uncomfortable, would be my guess. It is one of the more difficult parts of scripture we don't like to engage with too much. And it is one of the parts of scripture where I would say it is so crucial to understand this one in view of the bigger story, in view of the bigger context. So with that said, let us dive in. If you joined us for the 10:15 a.m. service, you will know that I talked about God continuing his rescue plan through the family of Abraham. And I love how the Bible Project actually visualized it. You know, you have this family and it is the starting point or the continuing point how God seeks to rescue humans, to rescue human life, to rescue humanity. And in that horizon, I think I am convinced we need to look at that story. And I would not just like to stay in this passage, but look what else does the Bible actually say about it. And if you flip to the New Testament, you can actually find a reflection and an interpretation, an analysis of this story through the viewpoint of God's rescue plan. If you will, please open your Bibles and read with me Hebrews chapter 11. I will just refer to 2-3 verses. Hebrews 11, which is quite at the end of the Bible, if you look at that book, and I start by verse 17 to 19. By faith, Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had received the promises was about to sacrifice his one and only son, even though God had said to him, "It is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned." Abraham reasoned that God could raise the dead, and figuratively speaking, he did receive Isaac from the dead. Now, Hebrews here makes a very crucial point. It says that this story is actually how God discerns and reveals himself as a God of the living. As a God of the living, not a God of the dead. And the way it starts off, this part, is crucial to understand the Genesis story or to have insight into what actually happens there between God and Abraham and Isaac. Hebrews says, by faith, Abraham offered his son. Now, in the Hebrew tradition, faith is not an objective. It does not mean, or is not a description of what you have faith in. No, in the English language, we would say it would describe what you believe in, what you have faith in, what you trust in. Now, in Hebrew, faith is to be understood as an action. And more, faith produces action. Faith means that one acts firmly towards God's will. Now, that we see, Abraham does that. But why? because God's will in this passage seems unreasonable. It seems outrageous, to be honest. It seems wrong. And you have Luther, Kant, and Kierkegaard discussing this. Kant, who sees this on a moral level and really struggles with that story because it is wrong to ask Abraham to murder his son. And this actually reminds me, because I had a conversation with one of my teachers in secondary school, and I saw my teacher struggle with the same passage, and he came to the conclusion, well, that is actually the first time the Bible establishes fundamentalism. This is a valid view on the story, but this brings me even more to the certainty that we need to perceive this story in the bigger context, in the bigger storyline of God's redemptive rescue plan. Because faith does not just mean that God's will is arbitrary, or that it is somewhat mystical. Now, what the Hebrew understanding involves is that it is cyclical, that it re-establishes itself. That means His will, God's will, is never outside of His revealed work or instruction. And that is quite interesting, because if we look at the very beginning of the Bible, it starts with life. It starts with life and peace and newness. It starts, perhaps perfection would be a good word to describe it, the creation. And from that onward, God's will cycles back over and over again to this promise to re-establish this peace, to re-establish this harmonious, this pure relationship between humankind and God, as in the beginning. So faith is connected to an action. It is an acting towards God's will, which is never outside of His revealed work or instruction. All right, we got to understand this and got to keep this in mind. And then this story of Abraham and how Hebrews reflects on Abraham, at least for me, makes much more sense. Because this story becomes a foreshadow of God's sacrifice, where God would sacrifice Himself through Jesus. So this healed relationship could become true, so that this new creation could become true in the midst of the old. And this is the fascinating aspect of Hebrews. This is the fascinating take Hebrews establishes here. Hebrews, the author, explains to us that Jesus didn't do something magically new or something that was outside of God's instruction or outside of his revealed work. Hebrews makes clear that what God did in Jesus Christ, sacrificing himself, his son, and 3 days later, rising from the dead, that this is something he established from the beginning. It's cyclical. So with Hebrews, we understand that the matter of faith is at the essence of the story of God, Abraham, and Isaac. The matter of faithful action. And this concept of faithful action is something we see repeatedly in the Old and the New Testament. What the author of Hebrews points out, action by faith, that means actions, as I said earlier, that are born out of this conviction that God acts as he has done in the past. So yes, through Hebrew, we see and understand that this story about Abraham, Isaac, and God is a story of faith, of faithful action. And perhaps you find yourself in a situation where you've been praying, or where if you have been anticipating something that hasn't happened yet. Perhaps you find yourself in a situation confronted with difficulty, where you need to make a decision that seems to be beyond you and what you are capable of deciding on. Then I want to encourage you to take heart and to be faithful. And by that I mean to review and see how God has acted in the past, in what you read in the Bible and perhaps in your own life. How you see him revealed. And take that as a promise for your now, for your present moment. And another aspect I would like to share with you, because it takes a lot to do this leap of faith. But how marvelous to then see how God provides. And he did, not only in the story of Abraham and Isaac through the ram, but then also through his son. And he does again, over and over, now, through one another, through us the church. He is revealed presence now. So in faith, let us take hold on to that. And let us go forward by being certain of what we do not see yet, but what we have seen and read of in the past.
king, clothed in majesty. But all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great, how great is our God. Age to age he stands, time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great
together. I'll be remembering students and the local community, along with some world issues, ending with a prayer from the Anglican Church. And so, Father God, as we pray together, we bring before you the needs of others. We think about our local community and the restrictions that continue to limit everyday life. With many students coming to flats and halls over the past weeks, we pray particularly for those new to the city. In a time when so much of life has moved online, may they still be able to get to know new people and build friendships. As well as a time of learning and understanding for them, may this also be one of safety and growth. We ask your blessing on those we know who have moved away from Edinburgh, remembering especially Heather now beginning her studies in London. And we pray for the students who are part of our fellowship here. Give them strength and resilience in these times, and a deepening knowledge of your presence and your guiding. We continue to pray for the wider issues that affect our world, some of which seem to have been squeezed out of our view during the pandemic, and others that have come into sharp focus. We pray particularly for effective action on climate change and environmental damage, that political and community leaders will heed the warning signs we see, and that uncomfortable individual sacrifices we need to take won't prevent coordinated action. and we think about the way the Black Lives Matter campaign has highlighted the injustice and discrimination that many have to face day to day because of race, a constant background to their lives. For these issues, we are aware of the responsibility we have to take action and speak out. Help us to follow Jesus' call to be the people who look after our neighbours and not ones who walk past on the other side when we see injustice and harm. We remember those facing loss, particularly those who are caring for the seriously ill or have suffered recent bereavement. We continue to pray for Andrew Robertson's family and friends after Andrew's funeral on Friday, remembering especially Betty and Brian. In a time when we are not able to meet together to remember and celebrate the gift of a life, and where networks we use for support are not always available, may we grow closer to you and deepen a knowledge of your care in and through all situations. Finally, we again give you thanks for the carers and medical staff and all those working in the NHS, people willing to give of themselves in difficult and stressful situations. We pray your blessing on them, grant them peace, and keep them in your safety. Keep us, good Lord, under the shadow of your mercy in this time of uncertainty and distress. Sustain and support the anxious and fearful, and lift up all who are brought low, that we may rejoice in your comfort, knowing that nothing can separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, John, for praying with us. Let us now sing 10,000 Reasons. 10,000 reasons to remind us of God's grace. 10,000 reasons to remind us of His goodness towards us. 10,000 reasons that encourage us to take a step in faith.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Oh.
So God be with you. May he remind you of his presence in your past and in your present. He's around you and he will provide. And may he bless you with courage to take each day in faith. Amen.